Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarah, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. We are in Amrutanubhava. We have concluded the book without ourselves getting concluded. Anyway, now we get into the concluding analysis. Here, this is not a part of the text proper, but it is an analysis given by our Swamiji. The basic difference between the approaches expounded by Sant Jnaneshwara and by Adi Shankara needs to be clearly understood, because such an understanding is important in the process of spiritual sadhana. The attitude of the seeker and the nature of efforts he puts in on the spiritual path. Adi Shankaracharya, he talks about he also is talking about the one without a second principle. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is also talking about the one without a second principle, but their approach about the creation, they say, Adi Shankaracharya says, the whole creation is a superimposition on the reality, whereas Jnaneshwar Maharaj says it is an expression of the reality, because without the reality, how can the so in other words, wave is a superimposition on the water is the standpoint of Adi Shankara, and Jnaneshwar Maharaj says it is an expression of water. It's not other than water. So they're talking the same thing, but they're looking at it differently. So then you don't have to get worried about removing the water, waves. Superimposition we want to remove. Here Jnaneshwar Maharaj says the great, here. So that is the main thing, but let's go ahead. The great masters. Great masters are so different from an average individual that right from childhood, they manifest the highest knowledge apparently without sadhana. Adi Shankaracharya composed the Kanakadhara Stotram when he was only 8 years old. Jnaneshwar Maharaj had given out the highest knowledge by the time he was 20 years of age, after which he withdrew from the world and entered Sanjeevani Samadhi. 300 years later, Sant Eknath Maharaj, who followed the same Siddha Marg as Sant Jnaneshwara, was ordered by the latter to open his samadhi and remove the roots of the tree that were hurting him. When Sant Eknath did as he was told, Sant Jnaneshwara asked him to re-edit the Jnaneshwari, removing the interpolations. Removing the interpolations. The version that is accepted today is the re-edited version of Sant Eknath. All these manifestations are outside the scope of cause and effect. We can only wonder at them. Therefore, Bhagwan Krishna in Bhagavad Gita chapter 2 verse 29 described the truth as Ascharyavat Ahati Acharyate Yasmin Iti Acharya Ascharya, having seen which and having experienced which, one's intellect is simply stunned. It does not comprehend how it has happened. So So when we see miracles, when we see inhuman potential being expressed, we are in wonderment. Same thing in the nature also, whenever something unexplainable comes, the expression happens, we are unable to comprehend and we get into a dazed sort of state. When we, yesterday someone sent me a SMS and a small kid, 3 years old, he is singing Sai Bhajans. I'll show it to you afterwards. And he can't even speak properly, not even three, maybe two, maybe less than that. Can't even speak. Yama, yama, ye, ye, ye. Not Rama, Rama, hare, hare. Rama, yama, yama, aye, aye. But at that age, he is singing the entire bhajan in tune. At 2 years old. Imagine. And naturally, it's just a wonderment. And that's what Swamiji is saying here. Importance of open-mindedness. When the philosophies expounded by the great masters are studied, it is a natural tendency to compare favoring one and not favoring another, and thus developing biases. This tendency has to be strictly discouraged in a spiritual seeker. His mind should be kept totally open so that wisdom can flow in from all sides. Don't become a cocoon. Don't become that this is what I am. And we have practiced this for a long time. Only this body I am. Already. Only this wife I am. Or we have defined ourselves in certain ways. And we do not allow ourselves to become more than what we are at the moment experiencing. His mind should be kept totally open so that wisdom can flow in from all sides. The Vedas say, let noble thoughts come from all sides. Who has said is not important, but what matters is what has been said. The principle or the tattva is not person-oriented, nor is it established in time. It is because of the tattva that everything is existing. Tattva, the essence. It is because of the essence, because of the everything is existing in this creation. So here, principle or the tattva, the essence is the principle. Without the water, wave cannot express. Without the gold, ornaments cannot express. What is that without which you cannot express or this creation cannot express? That principle, that infinite divine principle is because of which everything is happening. The approaches of Shankara and Jnaneshwara. Now here it says, keeping this caution in mind, see, man has been open-minded, that's why it has reached such a pinnacle in creation, in his development, science, technology, biology, geography, exploration. Today, your life has become so comfortable only because of open-minded of some people who did not allow themselves to be cowered down by the present circumstances and had the daring and the open-mindedness to think beyond the norm. And therefore, these all discoveries come, like email, like YouTube, like light, like heating. All this was not there once upon a time. It's only when you think out of the box. And even in spirituality, you have to think outside the box. It requires even more so than just the science. So keeping this caution in mind, which caution? Don't become closed. Don't compare one to the other. Be open-minded. Try to see the vision that is being presented. let us examine the philosophical approaches of these two great masters, Adi Shankara and Sant Jnaneshwar Maharaj, which can be termed as an A, all-exclusive, and B, all-inclusive. So, Shankaracharya propagates all-exclusive and Jnaneshwar Maharaj propagates all-inclusive. So, what I gave the example of Vivarta and Chidvilasa. Before we begin the analysis, it must be clearly understood that both the approaches are rooted in Advaita Tattva, means in the non-dual truth, both approaches, and nothing less than the Advaita, the non-dual truth. The difference lies in their approach in expressing the Advaita Tattva. The main difference in the two approaches are, Adi Shankaracharya's approach is called Shanta Brahmavad, and Sant Jnaneshwar's approach is called Ishvara Advaitavad. So what are the difference? That's what Swamiji is going to tell now. And there are under these two approaches, then there are how many points that he has given? Each aspect, how they look at it, he has explained. There are 9 points there. So first one, what is the first? How both of them are looking at the same thing but in a different way? One is looking at, so here the first point is jnana versus vimarsha, or nishkriya versus kriya, activity versus inactivity. How or knowledge, so how is it inclusive and exclusive? Adi Shankaracharya is exclusive, he practices exclusivity, neti neti, I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the thing, I am the atma, and then when realization happens, everything is all inclusive. But Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he doesn't begin anywhere that I am not the body, I am not the mind. From beginning he says, I am everything. I includes everything. So you are the first. According to Sant Shanta Brahmavad, Paramatma Tattva is only Jnana Swarupa, it is Nishkriya, meaning Paramatma, the infinite reality, is of the nature of knowledge. His nature is knowledge, according to Adi Shankaracharya. The nature of conscious, pure, the reality, the absolute, is knowledge, and it is free of all activity. No activity is possible in it, because activity is always between the two. Between where there is separation, there is activity. Where there is difference, there is activity. And the reality is complete, so no activity possible. This is Adi Shankaracharya's approach. We'll look at it as Swamiji unfolds. According to Ishvara Advaitavad, according to Sant Jnaneshwara, Paramatma is not only Jnana Swarup, he also has Vimarsha, the Kriya. According to the Kashmiri Shaivism or Jnaneshwar Maharaj, that reality is not only of the nature of knowledge, but it is also of the nature of activity. Because if activity was not inherent in it, then if waves were not inherent within the water, how could they appear? They must be inherent. So the potentiality was inherent within the water to express as waves, isn't it? Whereas Adi Shankaracharya is saying, water is water, Don't bring wave in it. Wave is only an imagination. Wave is only a superimposition. Wave is only your identification with name and form. Actually, everything is water. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying that the water within itself has the potentiality to express as waves. And that expression, you don't need to discard that expression, Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying. Just accept it, that is the game that the infinite reality is playing with itself. Understand? Gita says in the chapter 10, verse 7, he who has understood this yoga knowledge aspect and the vibhuti manifestation or vimarsha aspect, the activity aspect, comes to possess unfailing devotion. The nyatrutva and kartrutva, the knowership and doership, are both essential qualities of Paramatma. The knowledge aspect and the activity aspect, both are aspects of Paramatma. Means, without Paramatma, activity cannot happen. Adi Shankaracharya takes you away from activity. That absolute, like for example, sunrise and sunset is an activity of sunrise and sunset. But sun is inactive. Understand? Here in this example. That's what Adi Shankaracharya is saying, that activity cannot be possible in the original. But Jnaneshwar Maharaj says that no, activity is possible because it is inherent within the reality. Without reality, the activity, by itself, activity cannot happen. The presence of the reality, Shankaracharya says, the example given in Shankaracharya is, you have a magnet and you got iron filings. The iron filings start moving by themselves in the presence of a magnet. Right? But that is just an example. But here we are talking about reality. And this reality is all inclusive. There is nothing outside of it. Shankaracharya also comes to the same conclusion. Agent for activities. Swamiji is taking us step by step. I'm jumping. The second point is agent for activities. As a consequence of the difference in approach, as above, the two philosophies have different ways of explaining the activity or manifestation that is seen all around. The Shanta Brahmavad assigns, that is Adi Shankaracharya assigns this agency to avidya or maya and postulates that Ishvara becomes active when he is under the influence of or with the help of Maya. So this Maya becomes Sattva Rajas Tamas, the Sattva Rajas Tamas then becomes the five elements, the five organs of perception and mind, intellect, memory and ego. And this way the whole thing, and then Ishvara enters. But where did this Maya come from? Anyway, this is what Adi Shankaracharya says. That when he is under the influence of Maya or with the help of Maya, he creates the creation. He cannot create it by himself. He creates it with the help of his potentiality. He invokes that potentiality with the Maya. The Ishvara Advaitavad refutes this point of view and claims that Ishvara is Swatantra, independent, meaning Ishvara is independent and free. He has total freedom to act or not to act. Therefore, activity belongs to the Lord and not to the Prakriti. Activity belongs to the Lord and not to the potentiality. That's what he is saying. Therefore, activity belongs to the Lord and not to the Prakriti. Maya does not control Paramatma, but Maya is his Shakti. Maya or the Prakriti or the potentiality is his power. It cannot control the Ishvara. It cannot control the Divine. In the first chapter of Amrutanubhava entitled Shiva Shakti Samavesha, the immediate potentiality of Paramatma is Shakti, and like the fire and its potentiality, the heat, Shakti is not a problem to Paramatma, but she is his glory. Out of Shakti alone, Maheshwara, the Lord Shiva, is able to manifest as the total world of names and forms, and therefore Paramatma is very much immanent in the total creation. Immanent, present. Just like wave is, what is that power because of which water is expressing as waves? Whatever that power is, Maya Shakti. Is the wave other than the water? No. The water is immanent in all the waves. It doesn't have to enter into the waves. It's already there. It was not the wave was created and then the water entered it. Like in Shankaracharya says, the Maya expressed as the creation and then the Lord entered into it. That is the explanation given there. So there also it's said that the Maya is nothing but Ishvara's, the Brahman becoming available to his potentiality is called as Ishvara. So Ishvara with respect to Maya, Maya multiplies and Ishvara enters into the creation that the Maya has created. Jnaneshwar Maharaj saying, nahi Baba, nahi. It was not that Maya entered, Maya expanded and then the Ishvara entered. Maya cannot be other than the Ishvara. Potentiality cannot be other than the wielder of the potentiality. This is their argument. This is the standpoint of, they are talking about the same thing, both of them. But it's just how they are looking at. Someone is looking at you and saying, mom. Another one is looking at you and saying, wife. It's one and the same thing. No, there's no question. Can any time wife versus mom ever meet? As a personality, they can never. These two are arguing. No, she is mom. No, she is wife. But you know you are both. Isn't it? Exactly the same way. These two masters are looking at it from different points, but what they are talking about is the same reality. Just like mom and daughter are talking, father, husband and daughter are talking about the same woman. Status of Maya, undefinable versus real. Maya is expounded in the Shanta Brahmavad as anirvachaniya. Inexplicable by the Adi Shankaracharya, it is explained as inexplicable. Appears yet doesn't appear. Is and at the same time is not, like a mirage. That which cannot be defined, it cannot be called Sat or Asat or both. It cannot be called as existing, it cannot be called as non-existing, both. It cannot be said to be with parts or without parts. So what are the parts? Sattva, Rajas, Tamas and all the others that I know. And without parts? You can't say it like that also. In the Ishvara Advaitavad, from Kashmiri Shaivism or Nath Sampradaya point of view, Maya, which is called Shakti, is perfectly as real as the heat in the fire. they take the Maya to be also reality. Because if the potentiality or the power has come out of the reality, how can it be unreal? See? How can it be unreal? As the heat in the fire. So, heat in the fire is unreal, is it? It is its quality. It is its own, it is its characteristic. And not imaginary. So also the Shakti and the Shaktiman cannot be separated, and the former is as real as the latter. So according to Jnaneshwar Maharaj, the Shiva and Shakti, the Shakti, the wielder of the power and the power, both are equally real, valid. Non-dualism, fourth point, non-dualism. Exclusive versus inclusive. According to Adi Shankaracharya, Maya being undefinable, it is loosely associated with Ishvara. In the final analysis, it is unreal and hence seems to play the role of a separate principle. Therefore, non-dualism is exclusive where Maya is not. Maya is even defined as Ma means not, plus Va means that. That which is not is called Maya. So according to Adi Shankaracharya, Maya, he excludes in the final analysis. He excludes the Maya. In that absolute, there is no place for Maya. In the eyes of the water, there is no place for the wave. Because when water looks everywhere, it looks at itself only. So it doesn't give a validity to a wave as a wave. And that was the standpoint of our Adi Shankaracharya. Now Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, according to Sant Jnaneshwara, Maya is not Kalpana, Kalpana and imagination. It is Shivamayi. It is of the nature of Shiva. It is of the nature of consciousness itself. It is very much Chinmayi, and essentially the Paramatma is the Paramatma's Shakti. So Shiva and his Shakti are not two principles, and therefore non-dualism is all-inclusive. So they are talking about that infinite reality, and he says that infinite reality, the Paramashiva or the absolute, and the infinite and his potentiality, they are both not separate. They are one and the same. So, in other words, Adi Shankaracharya is saying, you give up all, as a woman, you give up all your personalities, you give up all your identifications, so-called identifications, with body, breath, mind, intellect, etc., etc., and come to recognize yourself as that independent principle. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying that this body, breath, mind, intellect, all the roles that you are playing in your life are expression of that one consciousness only. So there is no question of running away from anywhere. See the difference, what they are showing? This is the main difference there. So Shiva and Shakti are not two principles, and therefore non-dualism is all-inclusive. Destruction of Maya versus surrender to Maya. According to Adi Shankaracharya, Shankara Vedanta, Maya is destroyed by knowledge of the Brahman. Once you come to know the reality, there is no place for Maya. According to Jnaneshwar Maharaj, one does not conquer Shakti. One surrenders to Shakti. Just as we surrender to the laws of nature, the world is Dvandvatmika, existing in pairs of opposite. No one can destroy it. One can only accept it. So, just like fire can destroy, but you follow the rules and regulations, fire can be helpful, isn't it? Exactly the same way. This world, according to Jnaneshwar, he says, surrender to the Shakti, surrender to the power. And therefore, the Kundalini Shakti, and they surrender to that power. And then what happens? There he says, just as we surrender to the laws of nature. You are surrendered to the gravity, you are surrendered to the sunrise and sunset, you are surrendered to the elements that are surrounding you. You don't have any question. Why am I not flying? Why am I only walking? Why don't I walk upside down? Why only walk on the legs and not on the hands? Why eyes are only seeing, ears are not seeing? All these are principles, is it, at the principle level. So, like you have just accepted it, there is no question about it in your mind, that why eyes see, why doesn't nose see, these questions don't appear. Exactly the same way, Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, just accept that Shakti is there, this power is there, and this power is not other than, rather than question, rather than discard, rather than I am not this power. This power is, it multiplies and takes me for a ride. Don't go into all that. Take that whole expression of the Shakti as not other than the infinite reality. And in this way, then there is nowhere to run. This is exactly what Shankara also says, that once you come to the conscious principle, it is an all-inclusive principle. The vision of the great masters is, once they come to the Atma, comes to the conscious principle, then that conscious principle is all that there is. Automatically everything is included in it. Examples you have seen, that just like you are feeling that you are everywhere in this body, once you realize what happens, you feel you are everywhere in this own creation. Because then creation becomes your body. Cosmos becomes your body. So there is no place that you are not. This is the disposition. Both are saying the same thing, but in a different language. The status of Jiva, inactive versus active. As per the Shankara Vedanta, the empirical ego or the Jiva or Atman is inactive. Because Atman is Brahma Sarupa and Brahman is without activity. So Atma is also without activity. Activities of the Jiva are contributed to Maya and its activity called Buddhi, the subtle body and the conditioning. So according to Shankara Vedanta, this conscious self is an inactive self. Inactive in the sense, it doesn't have to do anything in order to be. It is, because it is complete, so it is. It doesn't become a doer. Shankaracharya says the doership and enjoyership are two attributes given to the individual, and individual appears only in the matter. It is an idea in the matter. It has got nothing to do with the reality. Essentially, he is the reality. But this individuality that is expressing, it is an expression of Maya. It is not the expression of the infinite reality. But contrary to that, Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, all the fivefold activities of the Paramatma, that is, creation, maintenance, dissolution, wheeling, and anugraha, grace, are fully present in the jiva also, and therefore Bhagwan and jiva are essentially of the same nature. Veiling, avarna, and grace, anugraha, are both powers of the Lord. By His veiling, the Lord, as a part of His leela, creates a situation wherein we suffer and out of which we can extricate ourselves without His other power, the grace or anugraha. So, this whole drama, this mega drama that is going on called the creation, it is an expression of that divine alone, divine and His potentiality alone. And He is creating situations, He is creating knowledge also, He is creating the delusion also, He is creating the wheeling also, He is giving the grace also. There is nothing there, and every moment it is going on depending upon your availability. So as much as creation, maintenance and destructions are the expressions of the divine, that much wheeling and grace is also an expression of the divine, and it is all the time available. It's all the time happening. In the Shankara Vedanta, it is told, it is the buddhi which gets wheeled, gets covered up by ignorance. And here it is, he is saying, no, this is the game that the Lord is playing. So, don't get into, this buddhi, I have to discard the intellect and I have to discard the mind. No, it is His game only. You, it is your game, it is not His game. Because He alone is expressing through here. See, this whole thing is your expression. Now, with the respect to the universe, nature of the universe, name and form, Namarup versus Shivarup, unreal versus the real. According to Shankara Vedanta, the universe is mithya. Mithya means that which is existing in its own absence. And manifestation means only name and form according to Shankaracharya. Thus, the non-dualism is exclusive of the universe. So that absolute principle is beyond name and form. You have to discard name and form in order to come to know the reality according to Shankara Vedanta. The wave has to give up its waveness in order to recognize that it is water. Gold has to give up its name and form. Ornament has to give up its name and form in order to be gold. So also an individual has to give up all his identifications in order to be the absolute truth. Thus, the non-dualism is exclusive of the universe, and therefore the universe does not belong to the realm of Paramatma. Oh, universe does not belong to the realm of Paramatma? No, because from Paramatma point of view, there is no universe. From the reality point of view, there is no universe. From the water's point of view, there are no waves. From the gold point of view, there are no ornaments. Water is much more than wave is just coming, the way it was explained there is, waves are just coming on the surface. Water is much, much deeper. You go inside, are there waves there? As long as you are only on the water, there are waves. But from water's point of view, there are no waves. Just like if you go and dive into the water, and when you go a bit deeper, when you look up, you can't see the waves. So from water's point of view, from the absolute reality point of view, there is no creation according to Shankara Vedanta. Now what does Jnaneshwar Maharaj say? He says, the universe is not name and form. it is of the form of Shiva. It takes a different standpoint altogether. It is of the nature of the reality. It is the display of the divine glory. There is no mithyatva about it. This is Jnaneshwara's all-inclusive vision and love. So, what is wave? Wave is nothing but the glory of the water. Wave is nothing but the glory of the water. So if it is glory of the water, why would you discard it? Shankaracharya discards it in order to come to the absolute. Both are talking the same thing, but one is talking about the world as existing in its own absence, and the Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying the world is an intrinsic part, not as name and form. But he doesn't accept name and form. He says everything is Shiva only. Everything is the divine only. So, what Shankaracharya says, what Shankaracharya says that from absolute point, there is no otherness, there is no name and form. Jnaneshwar Maharaj saying from beginning that yes, there is no name and form. Everything is the Shiva, is absolute only. So name and form is nothing but the absolute. Shankaracharya is saying there is no name and form from the absolute point of view. So now you see, like someone is telling you, there is no mother, daughter, sister, there is only woman. And the other one says, no, woman alone is mother, daughter, sister. It's the same thing. Yes. See? Very subtle difference. So one is looking inwards, the other is looking, one is being exclusive when he says the woman is other than the mother, daughter, sister. Those personalities have to be discarded, they are existing in their own absence. Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, no, woman alone is expressing as mother, daughter, sister. So that is her glory. So don't discard it. Accept it. Surrender to it. This is Jnaneshwar Maharaj all-inclusive vision and love. Differences in approach to reality will always exist. They can be used in one or two ways. A. They can either be manipulated to strengthen differentiation and separateness, and B, they can be encashed to embrace all differences as Jnaneshwar Maharaj does. See? So either we can talk about differences and sit at our goalposts and keep arguing and discussing, or we can be all-inclusive and live in that glory of all-inclusivity, that wherever I go, whatever I think, whatever I breathe, whatever I eat, whatever I know or I don't know, everything is that Shiva only. So where is your attention? On the Shiva. Then you will behave with everything also correctly. If I have to behave Shiva, oh, this is Shiva, then I'll be respectful. In this philosophy, in his philosophy, everyone is at par. In Jnaneshwara's philosophy, everyone is par. Everyone is equal. Nobody is lower, nobody is higher. He takes the positive aspect of existence at all times and does not condemn or criticize any tradition or practice or opinion. This is the beauty of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. Whereas Shankaracharya, whenever he gives an explanation, he refutes other philosophies. The nihilist philosophy, the materialistic philosophy, the logical philosophy. He refutes all of them to establish his point. He shows how they are, where is the shortcoming in all of them. Whereas Jnaneshwar Maharaj, throughout his thing, he has never talked about other philosophies. We have not seen anywhere. This all-inclusive love manifests through all his expositions, a total joyful acceptance of as is, where is, whatever is. In the words of Ramana Maharishi, be as you are. In the Absolute Being, there is no contradiction. Wherever there is a contradiction, there is not only a fall to relativity, but also an obsession with relativity. This is the difference between an individual and Mahatma. We live in differences. Mahatma lives in unified vision. We are searching for divine. He knows he is the divine. We see divine in the temples and statues and different places. He sees divine everywhere. In the Absolute Being, there is no contradiction. There is not only a fall to relativity, but also an obsession with relativity. So wherever there is contradiction, wherever there is differences, wherever there is separation, we fall down to relativity. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, why you are thinking of differences? Can't you see it is all one? See? Where are the differences? I can't see any differences. Oh, no, no, waves are different. No, no, they are water only. Oh, I am seeing space, air, fire, water, earth. Oh, everything is space only. Without space, from the space only the air came. From the air, space only the fire, water, earth came. They are all expressions of this. Of that infinite. Where is the woman? Where is the mother, daughter, sister? No, there is no mother, daughter, sister. It's all woman only. All inclusivity. And in this way, come to that unifying principle, all inclusive principle. Jnaneshwar Maharaj also says, Shankaracharya also, initially he says neti neti. Neti neti means I am not this, I am not this, I am not this, I am not this. And then when he comes, then it is anvaya sadhana. Anvaya sadhana means all inclusivity. But in that all inclusivity, there is no acceptance of any multiplicity. In Jnaneshwar Maharaj's standpoint, all multiplicity is nothing but the glory of that one principle. See the difference? All the multiplicity is nothing but the vibhuti, the glory of that one principle. Shankaracharya is saying, there are no waves in water. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, all the waves are nothing but the glory, the expression of that one water. See, this is the difference. Eighth, vision of mukti, vision of liberation. According to Shankara Vedanta, liberation or mukti is attained when the universe is annulled. Universe is annihilated. Multiplicity is has been checkmated. In Jnaneshwar Maharaj's philosophy, the universe appears as the Lord Himself. Everything in the universe is Paramatma Swarup. everything in this whole creation is nothing but that one reality alone. Purnamada, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachyate. Nothing is other than that reality. It's only the defect in our vision. Only defect in our vision. Jnaneshwar says, correct the vision and you will see everything as divine only. Ishavasamidam sarvam yatkinchit jagatyam jagata. All that is in the world should be looked upon as the manifestation of reality. So says the Ishavasya Upanishad. If this was not so, if it were only mithya, a shadow, can we ever have concern or love for it? Can we have concern for the world? Can we have concern for the fellow beings? Can we have love for the fellow beings? Can we have love for the environment? When the divine is seen everywhere, with reference to space, every moment, with reference to time, in everything, with reference to object, which is present in every place, time, and in every form, how can that be unreal? In this way, the path shown by Jnaneshwar Maharaj is all-inclusive. That time is nothing but an expression of the divine, the space is an expression of the divine, and all the objects are also nothing but the expression of divine. Whether it is a drop, whether it is the froth, whether it is the wave, whether it is a tide, whether it is tsunami, all are nothing but water, expressions of water alone. You cannot discard them to come to know water. Shankaracharya said, discard them. Give up the name and form. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, why you want to give up name and form? Means you are giving, first you are given validity to name and form, and therefore now you are seeing that that is an impediment, so you have to discard it and come back to the water, to the original. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, instead, straight away take the position of the absolute. When take the position of the water, look out, everything, I am only, and that is my glory only. So there is no question of, because giving up is very difficult. Letting go is very difficult. How can you give up being a mother? How can you give up being a sister? How can you give up being a wife? No, I have to grow beyond these personalities. How will you do it? It can be done. I'm not saying it can't be done, because we have studied Shankaracharya, so we have seen by coming back to the conscious principle, just like you go to sleep, everything gets discarded, isn't it? But how long will you keep going back to sleep or back to the self? Here Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying from the beginning itself that take the position that in and through you the divine alone is expressing. The consciousness is also divine, and the material, the equipment through which he is expressing, that is also nothing but made of the divine material. If you take that position from the beginning itself, then there is no running, then there is no guilt, then there is no expectation. Your attention is straight away on the divine. And in this way, Jnaneshwar Maharaj has the all-inclusive approach. How is avidya to be overcome? This is the last point, I think. Yeah. In this, according to Shankaracharya, avidya, that is ignorance, is removed by vidya, the knowledge. And thereafter, the individual jiva attains liberation. This is done by shravanam mananam nididhyasan. This is done by listening, reflecting and contemplating. According to Jnaneshwar Maharaj, there are two kinds of ignorances. One, Paurusha Ajnana or eternal ignorance, this is inherent. And the second, Baudha Ajnana or ignorance caused by the conditioning of the buddhi or intellect. All of us suffer from this ignorance. We are suffering from the second one. we are not suffering from the first one. The first one is a phenomena. You understand what Shankaracharya says? This phenomena is eternal, of the infinite expressing through Maya. That is an eternal phenomena. Nothing can be done about it. Just the language is different. And Jnaneshwar Maharaj here says that the first part, the eternal ignorance, that phenomena is going on. And the second one, which we are affected by, which is the conditioning of the buddhi or the intellect. Vidyaranya Swami says in his Panchadashi that the jiva suffers not from Ishvara Srishti, but from the jiva Srishti. Ishvara Srishti, the creation of the Lord. He does. We don't suffer from the creation of the Lord. We suffer from the our own creation, which is created by the jiva himself. Nothing can be done to change the Lord's creation, but to change our attitude towards the Lord's creation is in our hands. This is what I keep telling again and again. A pessimistic looks at the world and sees difficulties and challenges. Optimistic looks at the world and sees opportunities, and a master looks at the same world and sees only the divine, the perfection. So where is the change? World is the same. World is the same. So where has the change happened? In our attitude. So that's what is told here, the individual who is considering himself to be a conditioned entity, instead of changing the conditioning, a master has not changed the conditioning, he's still in the same body, isn't it? Before he was a seeker, he was in the same body. Before that he was an ignorant person, it was the same body. The conditionings were there of the five koshas. After realization, the five koshas are also there. Then where has the change happened? In his vision. Why it has happened? Because of the realization that he has had. So here it is told that when, what is the realization? He purifies his intellect, or he reformats his intellect. And as a result of that, he dissolves his intellect by thinking about everything as the divine. And the vision that he has eventually, when he looks at the whole world through his senses, is that everything is divine. But to change our attitude towards the Lord creation is in our hands. Once sadhana can only be directed to get out of this jiva srishti. It is the jiva created problem that someone is mine and someone is not mine, that someone is a friend and that someone is an enemy. So the jiva alone, by his own efforts and sadhana, can get out of this bandha ajnana by discarding it. So says Vidyaranya Swami. And in this way, we'll finish this. Now the next point that is taken as entering Ishvara Srishti. After discarding the ajnanam, ignorance of jiva srishti, the individual creation, one enters the Ishvara Srishti. So once you have given up your individual creation of me and mine, I and mine, you move into the total creation, the macro. When a seeker, by the process of listening, shravanam, mananam and edidhyasanam, reflecting and contemplating, slowly and steadily conquers the individual creation, the bauddha ajnana, the ignorance which is expressing through the intellect, individual intellect, when he gives that up by thinking about the higher, by controlling the various faculties, he reaches a point where Brahmanuchintanam is continuously going on. He reaches a point where naturally the mind is, intellect is contemplating on the infinite reality. That how this reality could be all inclusive, how this reality could be the one without a second principle. This is continuously going, and that I am, this continuously is going on. It is an uninterrupted experience of aham brahmasmi vritti brahmano chintanam. So, that eventually leads to I am the Brahman, as I just said before, and that is the ultimate. Up to this point is the seeker's effort. Beyond that, his effort has zero value. It is only the Lord who can pull or suck him into the realm of Ishwara Srishti, the second level of ignorance, the Paurusha Ajnana. In the Ishwara Srishti, there is no enemy, no friend, nothing to gain or to lose. It is a life of intoxication in divine surrender. Is there an example? Yes, there is. It will be, a wave is fighting with a wave for its survival. It's competing, comparing. But when that wave realizes that it is the ocean, then what will be its disposition? That is one part. Ocean is that who knows that it is water only, but when it looks out, it says, all the waves I am only. Ocean. That in all the waves I am only expressing. So will there be any competition? Will there be any comparison? What is the disposition of the ocean? All inclusivity. Understand? It is not excluding, oh, this wave is not in me. No, all waves are in me only. I am only expressing in all the waves. And in this way, when everything is you only, we are not talking only about individuals. We are talking about the time, space and objectivity. Everything is in me. I am alone expressing in and through all these three. Then what will be your state? You will go mad. You will go mad with joy. And that is what is called divine ecstasy. When you realize that you are everything. You feel connected. I can't use the word you feel connected to everything, because then everything is separate to you. Arrival of Lord's grace, Shaktipat. Further purification is achieved only by the grace of the Lord called Shaktipat. This grace means the dawn of the divine power on us to help us come out of the limitation and keep us on the track of spiritual unfoldment. Thereafter, one starts living life the way a mirror reflects, reflecting everything, retaining nothing. What helps at this stage is what Bhagwan Krishna told Arjuna after 17 chapters of intellectual wisdom. The wisdom of absolute surrender. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. Rejecting all the dharmas, rejecting all the responsibilities, the dharmas of the gross body, man, woman, varna, ashram, young, old, prana dharma, manasa dharma, buddhi dharma, surrender completely to the Lord. And in this way, here what Swamiji is telling is, the individual, where the individual is, there alone the total is. And there alone the absolute also is. So consciousness is expressing as the individual consciousness. The same consciousness, you can catch the total consciousness. And at the same place, you can also catch the absolute consciousness. Why do we call total consciousness? Because you see this total. Individual feels he is separate from the total. He is a part of the total. When you come to the total, you see the total is not other than you. See the vision? That you are not other than the total. Our total is not separate. That you are. And in this way, come to recognize this, and this can be experienced only by surrendering to the Lord, the ultimate principle. Jnaneshwara's invitation to universal love and sharing. Therefore, taking this approach to this inevitable conclusion, Jnanadeva invites the whole world to join in a celebration of plenitude and prosperity. In this prosperity, there is no poverty of sharing. The art of sharing whatever one has is an essential part of spiritual sadhana and is a very important method in becoming one with the totality. And this word you must have heard us saying again and again. The scriptures also saying, be a giver, don't be a taker in life. Give, give, share, sacrifice. That is a recognition that there is abundance in life. And that abundance is not in the world, that abundance is your nature, your essence. One who has developed this universal vision will be simpler than the simplest, at home everywhere, at every moment. He will respect everyone and harbor disrespect towards no one. He will accept differences as an inevitable way of nature, not to be discarded. That is how it is. Jnaneshwar Maharaj's point of view is, differences are there, accept, it's the same reality expressing. Furthermore, he will have reverence for elders and for the great masters. Gradually, this reverence will embrace every experience as the Lord's dispensation for his own good. As this experience of reverence in the widest sense of the word becomes stronger and stronger, love will envelop the whole world. There will be no sense of duality and otherness. No one is a friend, no one is an enemy. We have just happened to come together, not out of our choice, and we will go our separate ways again, not of our choosing. When this is realized very clearly inside one's being, total surrender to the Supreme will follow. In the surrender of the individual will to the will of the totality, flowers the evolution of the individual to the Absolute. Such an evolved individual remains every moment in the lap of the Lord, in the full trust that the Lord will take care of him. In this complete surrender, we see the Lord's presence not somewhere far away, but he is ear of the ear, mind of the mind, speech of the speech, as given in the Kena Upanishad. He alone is. In this all-inclusive, there cannot be hatred or discord or tension, only an atmosphere of love, understanding, forgiveness, forgetting, and above all, loving everyone as I love myself. With this identity, with the absolute Paramatma Tattva, the absolute reality is discovered, where is the delusion, where is the grief thereafter? Every moment is his divine grace alone. In this glory, live. This is the essence of the philosophy of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. Rather than discarding, include. Rather than seeing the differences, see the unity. And in this manner, the two standpoints of the two great masters, Shankaracharya, Adi Shankaracharya, and Sant Jnaneshwar Maharaj, were propagated. And with this, we come to the final conclusion or her Amrutanubhava. And let's see, next week we'll start again from the first chapter. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.